Hey everyone, this is the AP World History Review for the final exam I told you would be up online. So let's briefly review exactly what will be on the final. We're going to start with foundations, but this is what the final exam will consist of. Remember, the final exam is December 17th, and it's going to cover both all three of the units that we've covered this semester, Unit 1, 2, and 3. Unit 1 goes back to the first couple weeks of school. That's the Foundations and Transformations unit that stretches from about 10,000 BCE to about 600 BCE. Unit 2 is Reorganizing Human Societies, and that goes from about 600 BCE to 600 CE. It's also known as the Classical Era. And then Unit 3 is the unit that we're just finishing up, and that's the Age of Accelerating Connections. And that's 600 CE to 1450 CE, also known as the postclassical. So this first review will be a very brief review over the Foundations and Transformations unit. Check back for a review over Unit 2 and 3 as well. So Foundations and Transformations at the beginning, and we're going back to about 8000 BCE. Farming was just beginning. At this time, you still had a lot of nomadic clans. You still had a lot of migration taking place. At this time, we can go back to the fact that men led groups, it was patriarchal, but women still served vital roles. It's prior to 8000 BCE that we see a lot of the mother goddess figures that we talked about when we looked at the statue of the Venus of Willendorf as just one example of the mother goddess figure. We're starting to see transitions, especially as settling is taking place, to more patriarchal roles for society. Trade is almost non-existent because you're still dealing with a lot of small clans, and there are no civilizations set up as of 8000. By the end of this time period, by 600 BCE, we're moving into the Classical Age. That's when you have civilizations. The patriarchal social structure has been in place where women are largely seen as inferiors. Civilizations exist around the world, and you're beginning to see the concept of regional trade. So it's believed that humans began in Africa and then migrated outward. That's one of the theories that we discussed the first week of school. At first, they were nomadic, and the women were gatherers, so it was the hunter-gatherer organization. And around 8000 is when we start to see signs of the Neolithic Revolution, where human beings are learning to farm. It's also known as the agricultural revolution. So remember that that's starting somewhere around 8000 BCE for historians. The farming leads to settlements, and a lot of these settlements then turn into civilizations around 3000 BCE. This is when we trace many of the earlier civilizations that we talked about and did some research on. The traits of a civilization, remember these five traits. You have specialized labor, you have concepts of record keeping, there's an interest in science and art, you have monumental buildings, and you have some kind of political organization or political stratification. And the world's first civilization for most historians is Mesopotamia, located along the Fertile Crescent. So this was the Tigris-Euphrates civilization that we studied the first week. If you go back to the website and take a look all the way back to the first week or two of school, you'll see the Persian charts that you all created. Those would be excellent things to review for all of these civilizations we looked at. So you have Sumer, Mesopotamia. From this civilization is where we start to see evidence of the wheel, cuneiform, and Hammurabi's code. Remember the cuneiform we talked about as the specific form of writing that was used on stone tablets, where they would take mud and they'd let it dry, and then they'd write on the tablets, they'd write symbols. Another civilization, you have Egypt, for the pyramids, the pharaohs, upper and lower regions. Narmer, who's considered to be one of the first rulers, possibly creating the first dynasty of Egypt. And there's less cultural interaction with Egypt at this time, with any of the outside civilizations. Then you have the Indus, Mohenjo-Daro Valley, which is in India. This is where we see well-planned cities and sewers. And then in China, one of the very first that we talked about, we did discuss the Xia. And just to recall, just so you kind of remember what that organization was spelled like, it looks like this. And this is one of the first that we see at this time, prior to the Shang Dynasty. However, Shang is the one that we know more about. We start to see evidence of ancestor worship, the use of bronze in a lot of their art, that we see in a lot of the archaeological digs taking place for Shang Dynasty. Similarities among all four of these: you have writing systems, you have class systems, and they're all found near rivers. We talked a great deal about this, and you read about it in your summer reading, remembering that civilizations spring up around waterways simply to be able to produce farming, and they're able to settle down. From this, population begins to spring up. They have the need for more food, you have the need for more children, so population begins to grow at a rapid rate at this time as well. But those are the similarities that we see among all four of these. In other places of the world, like the Americas, you see civilization starting as early as 10,000 when it's believed that humans are crossing the frozen land bridge. The Olmec in central Mexico are one of the first civilizations to spring up. Remember, we just discussed the Olmec. They're the rubber people because they're one of the first that created or used rubber actually in a lot of their building. They played the ball game. They were one of the first to play the ball game that spread into several of the other Mexican civilizations. The Chavín also follow in South America as one of the first civilizations we see around this time. In Egypt, you have further south of Egypt, you have Nubia, the kingdom of Kush, and Meroe. They're developing at this time. And in China, you have the Zhou dynasty. And the Zhou is important to remember the creation of the Mandate of Heaven. You're starting to see the springing up of legalism, Confucianism, Taoism. This is happening at the same time as many other places in the world. It's one of those common phenomena that we see. And remember, it's called the Axial Age. Let me write it down for you. The Axial Age begins somewhere around 900 BCE, and many historians claim it goes all the way to about 300 BCE. But it's especially between the years 700 and 500 that we're seeing philosophers spring up all over the world. You see the creation of legalism, Confucianism, Taoism in the Hundred School movement during the Axial Age. You see the springing up of Socrates in ancient Greece. Actually, even prior to ancient Greece, you see the Buddha or Siddhartha Gautama spring up at this time as well. Zoroaster is springing up as well. So you're starting to see a lot of philosophical questioning of the world and the purpose of human beings in the world at this time that's creating philosophies and some of the religion. And just remember, that's called the Axial Age. So in the Middle East, you have the Hittites that use iron and chariots. They take over Turkey or Anatolia. The Assyrians from the Mesopotamian area, they were this warlike culture that created the world's first empire, the Assyrian Empire. After them come the Babylonians, and we discussed Nebuchadnezzar and the Israelites and monotheism. So it would be good to go back and review, especially ancient Babylon, the Babylonians, and the creation of Judaism as the first monotheistic religion. In the Mediterranean, you see Greece with the Minoans and Mycenaeans. The Phoenicians were also seafarers at this time, created purple dye in the first alphabet. Again, if you look back at the Persian charts from the beginning of the year, you'll see some of the research a few of you did on the Minoans and Mycenaeans, which would be good to review. In general, you have a lot of large migration movements, like the Indo-Europeans. They bring city-states. They come into contact with one another, causing a lot of cultural diffusion. We also see a lot of conflict. The building of empires and faster communication was helped with the use of horses. So horses become one of the greatest intellectual technological achievements of this era. You're able to travel faster, you're able to communicate faster, and you're able to create military. So larger empires were possible at this time. Here's just a map of the ancient civilizations of the Old World, just to kind of get a grasp worldwide on what we're talking about. From 3500 to 1000, you have Egypt in the Nile. Right over here, you have Nubia, and then you have Aksum. And the Tigris-Euphrates, which is Mesopotamia, Babylonian up here. You have the Minoan-Mycenaean, which is about 2100 to 1000, as well as the Shang Dynasty. And then the Indus Ganges civilization, the Vedic civilization. From the Indian civilization, remember the Aryan warriors that came down? They brought the caste system with them. It's one of the most important pieces to remember from the Vedic age of ancient India. And then you do have evidence of Zimbabwe and Mali springing up. We talked about those last time. Remember from these ancient states, especially of Mali, Sundiata, we looked at a clip from The Lion King, discussing that the Lion King most probably is from the Lion Prince, which is the tale of Sundiata, the Prince of Mali, who was lame, went away, came back, and ruled the kingdom, built up one of the first big dynasties in Africa. So, those are just a few of the civilizations to review. Again, my advice would be to go back, take a look at the Persian charts you all created. Make sure you look at the Unit 1, 2, and 3 resources page, because that will have a lot of the PowerPoints we went over, presentations, much of the reading that we did. And I'll also have some quick crash course review guides that you can go through, which are just a couple pages in length that gives a little bit more information. And of course, the biggest study aid for you will be your notes. So make sure you don't forget to take a look back at your notes from the Foundations Age. The questions for Foundations will probably be about 5 to 10% of the final exam. On the actual AP test, it'll only be about 5% of the test. So I'm going to try and hold true to the AP test for the final, where I would say about 40 to 45% will be from the classical and post-classical, and then about 5 to 10% will be from foundations, just so you kind of know the breakdown on the test. Again, check back for the Unit 2 and Unit 3 reviews. I will have those posted soon. Thanks.